Torna il sole sopra la città.
Whilst two-stroke technology revolutionized the smaller classes of Grand Prix racing, in 500cc a young Giacomo Agostini and MV Agusta had overthrown Mike Hailwood and Honda to dominate the premier class until 1972. Hago was just as effective in the 350 class, doubling up virtually every season to take no fewer than 12 world titles in just 7 years.
Il primo è difficile, il secondo è ancora più difficile e il terzo è ancora più difficile. Cioè ripetersi è molto difficile, perché devi sempre essere concentrato e non illuderti e pensare che tu sia il più bravo e che per te le cose sono facili.
Everything would change in 1973 when British rider Phil Reed arrived at MV Agusta. Firstly to ride the Italian factory's 350cc bike, and then the 500 as teammate to Agostini.
I remember as a fan, I thought this is going to be fun.
well, actually, Giacomo was the man to beat, and obviously he was on the very competitive machine with the MV Agustas. I think Giacomo had a hard time.
Yeah, I think we have a very hard time and good time also, because you know, Phil was a very good rider, very fast, and I think also I'm a good rider and very fast. And of course, when he came to MV Agusta, I am the like a boss, because it's an Italian factory and he came from England.
It was all good to create an atmosphere about Giacomo and myself were fighting each other.
The trophy is only one, and I won the trophy and he won the trophy. So it's what I say, it's very difficult to be a very, very good friend.
He was controversial. He liked to play games with teammates, and doing that, I felt that he gained an advantage.
Sometimes he make me nervous, because he go to the Conte Agusta and he come to me sometimes and say, "Hago, look, it's a packet of money." He said, "Conte Agusta give me this, give the present." Just making me angry, just say, okay. And I say, Conte Agusta give you a lot of money. But one day I discover it's not all money. Only the first and the last is the money. The other is the paper.
So we have a joke together, and this is trying to psych him out, you see, that Count Agusta.
He tried to make me nervous so he can win, you know.
Got brutal at the end, because Phil Reed effectively elbowed Agostini out. I don't think there was much love lost between them.
In 1973, the battle for the 500cc title would have a third protagonist, the newcomer Jaano Saarinen. The Flying Finn moved up to the premier class after winning the 250cc World Championship with Yamaha.
Jaano Saarinen, quando è arrivato nei Gran Premi, si è subito dimostrato molto forte, molto veloce. E poi soprattutto era anche un bravo tecnico. E come tutti i finlandesi, un grande coraggio aveva.
He said that he started racing because he wanted to travel and see the world.
I've never seen a rider ride so hard on the limit. He was just unbelievable, unbelievable. He was one of the few riders that were outstanding, like Marquez has come up.
In the 73, Yamaha came with a four-cylinder, two-stroke, to join the 500 class for the first time, and he won the first two races.
Saarinen was leading the 500cc World Championship ahead of Reed and Agostini when the series arrived at Monza for the Grand Prix of Nations on the 20th of May 1973. Just moments into the 250cc race, there was a multi-rider accident in which Saarinen and his rival Renzo Pasolini were both killed.
I remember Monza because Pasolini had the 250, and just I relaxed at the house of Contagusti. They have a small house, and Monza just relaxed because I waiting for 500. And I hear the start of the 250, and after 30 seconds, I hear nothing.
Yeah.
And I just think, oh, what happened? And after 2-3 minutes, the ambulance coming, and we understand this. You know, it's a big, terrible. Very big accident.
Terrible.
You could not believe it. It's one of the big tragedies in racing, you know, and had a lot of impact, you know, in the race world. Yamaha withdrew off the class. And, yeah, one of the biggest talents was gone.
Without a doubt, would have won the 500 world title. Probably that year for Yamaha, but he would have been the first two-stroke winner.
Well, he already had a 250 title, but he also wanted to get 500 title. 73, he thought it's going to be his year.
He deserved to win the championship because he was a superstar in the making. The slight faded before he could show it to the world.
The year finished with Reed claiming the 500 title with MV Agusta, a feat he would repeat in 74, the last world title for a four-stroke machine for another 28 years.
And sadly now, Phil is not revered in the same way as Hayward or Agostini. But you look at his race wins, you look at his world titles, he is right up there with the best. Right up there.
Agostini, who had replaced Saarinen at Yamaha in 1974, would make history the following season as the first champion of the exciting new era of explosive two-stroke motorcycles. The Italian retired in 1977 with 15 world titles to his credit. With 122 Grand Prix victories, he remains the most decorated rider of all time.
Quando mi chiedono i miei record, i record sono fatti anche per essere battuti.
15 volte campione del mondo è un record che, come ho detto prima, non dico impossibile, ma difficilissimamente sarà possibile batterlo.
Se Valentino un giorno battesse uno dei miei record, sarei felice per lui, perché vuol dire che dimostra ancora di più di essere un grande. E poi, se ci sarà una bella serata, penso e spero di festeggiarla insieme.
Non lo so, mi mancano ancora un po' di gare per arrivare a Agostini, e quindi sarà difficile raggiungerlo, ecco. Sarebbe bello avere questo problema di farlo o no con Ago, perché vuol dire che lo avrei raggiunto, ecco. Sarà dura, però comunque 122 vittorie di Agostini sono un numero veramente stellare, e già esserci arrivato vicino va bene, ecco, quindi speriamo di arrivarci ancora più vicino.
Per noi è una bella icona, è una gran bella icona Giacomo Agostini.
From a technical perspective, the invasion of two-stroke engines had revolutionized the World Championship. From a human perspective, another rider was set to start another kind of revolution.
It was the 70s, and it was still rather like the swinging 60s in Britain at the time. And there was two guys that came into sport then that were just adored in Britain because of the way they were. James Hunt and Barry Sheen. I mean, they were hooligans, weren't they? They were just.
He had the knack. You know, he ran around with the Beatles. He had the long hair. He had the look.
smoked cigarettes on the grid with a hole in his helmet. He was a carouser.
He was on the posters of wherever you looked. He was on TV ads for oil, for aftershave.
Would you like some of a Heavenly 15W40 oil, madam?
Certainly not.
He was a glamorous London boy, was seen with lords and ladies and highfalutin people. He moved motorcycling, I think, into glamour.
Everyone in the streets knew him because he had a nice wife, you know, ex-penthouse model, Stephanie.
They were the Victoria and David Beckhams of the era. They put motorcycling in Britain into a completely different place, from the back page to the front page of the newspaper.
When he started going out with his wife, that was a front page story on the biggest selling tabloid newspaper in the United Kingdom. That's what Barry Sheen was, a celebrity in the true meaning. Totally and utterly transcended motorcycle racing.
He understood the necessity of the fans, what the fans meant to him, what they meant to racing.
And I remember he went back to his motorhome and there was a queue 200 yards long of fans. And I remember going to the press room, doing all my stuff, getting in my car. 2 hours later, and Barry was still sat outside signing autographs.
Thank you.
When I was racing, everyone stood by Barry Sheen's garage. Now it's Valentino Rossi. He was the most popular rider of the era.
Barry was astute as a businessman. Very astute, just as good at business as he was at racing, and he understood what he had to give to a sponsor.
Okay, look, listen, the other thing, Giancarlo, the other thing is, okay, you send the contract through the post, okay? And I can't sign it because I've got to go to America tomorrow.
The track guy said to watch going in to the south banking and coming off the north banking. He said it's still damp out there.
Is it?
Yeah.
Barry had two massive crashes in his career. The one at Daytona was the first one.
Come on, let's go.
Yeah.
They crash about 250 kilometers per hour.
Unbelievable.
We're there.
Yeah.
And he never stopped. When he crashed, just he go for 300 meters.
Gee, I feel as if I've been barbecuing my arse and my back and my shoulders.
Did they ever get to that one?
And then the Silverstone one. Both horrible, multiple fractures to his legs.
I think I was one of the first people on the scene. And it was like an aircraft had crashed. They were still smouldering. There were still bits that were smoke coming off and everything. I mean, it was quite terrifying.
And he came back from both heroically. It added to the Sheen legend, of course it did, because what's better than a sportsman who overcomes adversity and comes back to win? A story anybody would love.
They're still on for the inside, both Barry Sheen. Barry Sheen taking eighth place, Van Zulman in ninth place, and there is our race winner.
Sheen didn't just recover from his horrific crash at Daytona in 1975. He went on to win the 500cc World Championship twice, in 1976 and 1977. His first title was also a first for Suzuki, as they too grabbed a piece of history in the 500cc World Championship. Sheen's dominance would end in 1978 with the arrival of a fearsome new rival, Californian dirt track star Kenny Roberts. The brash American brought with him a totally new way of racing a motorcycle.
Nobody knew what to call Roberts. You know, they had to call him something. They were Italians. And there had to be some reason that he was so good. There had to be something magic about it.
Martian. Marciano. I don't know why. You have to ask them why.
They said I was from another planet, so they named me Martian.
He's very small, he's dressed in yellow, and he comes from another planet. He must be a Martian, and that's the way they regarded him.
He came out of nowhere. Nobody had really heard of him.
Kenny came over from America. He didn't know any of the racetracks. He didn't know the Grand Prix scene. And it was a shock to the system, I think.
He ruined it all, didn't he, Kenny? Just everything was going along very nicely for Barry and Britain and everything else. And he revolutionised Grand Prix racing. Absolutely revolutionised it.
The way Roberts rode the bike was completely different. People weren't used to seeing the 500s smoking and spinning out of the corners. And Roberts said, the way you got to treat this asphalt, you got to treat it like dirt.
And riding style that we'd never seen before, riding a Grand Prix bike, sliding a Grand Prix bike. This will never work. This will never work. It worked.
I don't think Barry realised how good Kenny was when he first arrived.
It was a difficult time for Barry Sheen because, as everyone observed, Kenny came and started winning.
I didn't realise he was so big until I went to Europe. It was funny because we thought the GB on the back of the sticker on the car meant Go Barry, because every billboard and was him.
Barry absolutely hated it. He absolutely hated Kenny at the time. And what made it worse, that Kenny would just laugh. He was not fussed in the slightest what Barry said about him.
They were like professional wrestlers, you know, talking before the match, talking a lot of trash. I remember Barry said, when Kenny had a problem in one race, and Roberts explained the problem, Barry said, I thought this was the world's championship for motorcycle racing, not the world's championship for excuses. Wow, you know, that was headlines, motorcycle news. Sheen says Roberts is a whiner. They asked Roberts what he thought. Roberts said, Barry Sheen, I wouldn't piss on that guy if he was on fire.
Kenny, we make it, you still need 1 point to clinch the championship. Have you had time to do your sums yet?
No, he ain't been doing it while he's going around.
Because of his personality, because he was such a huge star, I couldn't wait for the next week to see what the press said, you know. And if he'd said something about me, then the press would come and say, oh, Barry said this about you. Then he's a wanker. He had no chance of winning that race. And anything like that, it just went on and on and on and just kept building and building and building.
Robert's wild sliding style would immediately prove effective, and in 1978 he won the 500cc World Championship at the first time of asking, becoming the first American ever to do so. King Kenny would prove untouchable for the next two seasons, picking up the 500cc title three times in a row.
Finish line, knowing full well that there are many rivals breathing down his neck.
Being the first guy to win the championship wasn't really a big decider for me. It was just winning. You know, I liked winning. And I loved beating Barry.
In Britain, everybody remembers the British Grand Prix at Silverstone. It was the epic, epic race.
And we're seeing a British Grand Prix, the likes of which we haven't seen.
And we're all just racing around. All of a sudden, it's me and Sheen.
At 160 miles an hour, and Roberts takes it. Roberts uses his superior power.
I tried to get away, no way.
And blasts past into the lead. Kenny Roberts then, the world.
And he knew the same thing. But when he would lead, he'd slow down a little bit. And then the second, third and fourth would catch up. So I was going, you know, get going. What are you doing?
And Roberts' hand off the throttle there.
And then he'd go by, and that's when he started doing the V sign. And I was doing this, and
people had never seen anything like that before.
And we just knew it was going to come down to the last lap, last corner. And it did.
This is it. At 130 miles an hour, the checkered flag is out. Kenny Roberts and Barry Sheen is gaining.
But I knew he wasn't going to get me on the inside. because Barry was a very safe guy. He didn't do any dirty tricks, and I covered the inside, and I won the race.
Won the 1979 Marlborough British Grand Prix.
I have a few races like that where people still talk about it today, and that's one of them.
Sure, it was rough on the racetrack for 2 years, but there was a real respect between those guys. And Roberts, when Barry died, Roberts was really, really moved by it, you know.
They became terrific mates. And then, I remember when we were in Brno, and the news came through that Barry had cancer. So this just sums up how it was. So Kenny rang him up from Brno, and we were all a bit chatting. Barry answered the phone. He said, "Oh," he said, "Barry, thank God you answered the phone. You're not dead yet," he said. Kenny said, "I mean, that's the way it was. They were just bouncing off each other. I mean, so they became very good friends and massive respect for each other."
To a British motorcyclist of my generation, it's difficult not to get emotional. He was everything. And when he went, when he went far too early, you think the hole that left, you know, a bit of our history as British motorcyclists just went.